be a second.
I'm trying to steal the.
Tried to fly?
Just like Rotary, I'm going to find you, Frank.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for being here this morning, and welcome to the Board for Land Use hearings and adjustments in the Zoning Board of Appeals for the City of Bonita Springs. My name is Roger Brunswick. I'm your chairman, and welcome. We have two cases on the agenda today, but first and foremost, I want to mention, is anybody in the room for the Oakland Commercial Plan Development CPD? Anybody here for that? Raise your hand if you are. I don't see any hands. That case has been continued to, I think it's 18th of next month. So for the record, we've made that announcement. Good. And then one other thing, a question that's come up, and I want to let Alex, Assistant City Attorney, speak to this, but we are the case this morning, which has to do with the Bonita Springs Fire Control and Rescue District. One of the district member board members is Frank Lyles, who also sits on this board. So in case anybody thinks that there might be issues related to that, Alex, would you go on the record and tell us, give us an opinion?
Sure. State ethics law generally would require you to abstain from voting and participating if you have a conflict. A conflict would be if you were voting on an action that might, the way they term it, is inure to your special private gain or interest. The opinion is that this does not inure to your special private gain or interest as a member of the Fire District Board.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. And does anybody else wish to raise any questions about that? If not, we'll continue along. We all set? Okay, seeing no hands. So, Alex, will you call the first case, please?
I will, and if I could, just to read into the record the case name
for
the
second. Oh, excuse me, Alex.
Alex, I'm sorry.
Time out. I'm sorry. Roll call. Thank you. Oh, wait, we got a couple of things. We got an invocation, we got a pledge. I'm rushing ahead here. Will you, Robert, do the invocation for us, please. Everybody, please stand.
We ask for your blessing that this board be guided with wisdom and understanding in its decision making. For all those who protect us at home and abroad, please keep them safe and bring them home safely. Amen.
Okay, and while we're standing, Frank Lyles, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please? Yes,
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Thank you. Sorry, I forgot those important things. Roll call, please.
Robert and Serpy.
Here.
Barbara Barnes Buchanan.
Here.
Chairman Brunswick. Richard
Here.
Donnelly.
Here.
Frank Lyles.
Here.
James Worcester.
Here.
We have one vacancy and one member. Watch your cup there, Frank, or Robert. And one board member is not here today. All right. Now then, Alex, will you please call the first case?
Sure. I'll state my name first for the record. It's Alex Boswell, Eversole, Assistant City Attorney. Also, if I could, I want to read the second case into the record with a little more detail, and I'll do that first. That's going to be case number PD16-29060-BOS, the Oakland Commercial Plan Development. The location there is 27971 Oakland Drive in Bonita Springs, Florida. The case will be continued. The action will be formalized on October 18, 2016, and then rescheduled for November 15, 2016. And that's at 9 a.m. And then to the first case on the agenda, this is case, it's a variance, and it's 16-324-6063, BOS, Hickory Boulevard setback variance. The location here is 26105 Hickory Boulevard, Bonita Springs, Florida, with a strap number of 2547-24B2-00002.001. Zero. Mike Fegan, planner with community development, has previously been tendered as an expert in planning and land use. And he'll initially present the case.
I just want to interrupt before you get to that, that Barbara Barnes Buchanan, for the record, is here.
Thank you.
Good morning, Barbara.
And I could also swear folks in who are members of the public right now. Members of the public who wishes to speak? To swear you in, if you could state your name, raise your hand, raise your right hand.
Rick Steinmeier.
Do you swear or affirm to tell the truth, whole truth, or nothing but the truth?
I sure do.
Thank you. All right, with that, we can proceed. If I could get you to state your names for the record and then raise your right hand.
Tim Fernandez.
Greg DeWitt.
Do you swear or affirm to tell the truth, whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I did.
Thank you. And then we also have some other experts to tender here, I think.
Okay, yeah. She was prodding you.
So with staff, we have several members who have previously been tendered as experts. We have Mike Kirby, expert in environmental the matters in front of the city. And then we also have Jacqueline Genson. She's been previously tendered as an expert in planning and land use. John Dolmer, who's previously been tendered as an expert in planning and land use, and we have Stuart Smith, and these folks are all with community development. Stuart Smith's been previously tendered as an expert in engineering.
Thank you.
With that, I think we can proceed with the first case, and as I said, Mike Fegan, community development planner, previously been tendered as an expert.
Good morning, everyone. Again, Mike Fegan, community development, for the record. To discuss this case here that was presented or requested by the Bonita Springs Fire Control and Rescue District with regards to a setback variance. To confirm the request, as Alex already stated, the request is to grant a 22.3-foot reduction for a street setback along Hickory Boulevard and a 12.4-foot reduction for a side yard setback for an accessory structure in conjunction with a fire station pursuant to 4-1893 and 4-662 of the Land Development Code.
Mike, if I could interrupt, I believe the wording in that is wrong. It's a 2.7-foot reduction. The setback will be 22.3.
That is incorrect. They are requesting a 22.3-foot reduction from the street setback.
Oh, I saw it differently.
The request is for a 22.3-foot reduction for the street setback, which requires a 25-foot setback along Hickory, and a 12.4-foot setback reduction to a side yard setback where it would normally be 15. Some background for the case. The address in question is 26105 Hickory Boulevard, as Alex has stated. The zoning of the property is C1. It's a commercial zoning designation that right now does permit a fire station use by right. The land use, the future land use category, is general commercial. And it's staff's understanding that this specific location was chosen as a way to improve response times to Hickory Island. There are several metrics that the applicant uses to determine whether or not it is successfully meeting its goals of protecting the city in emergency situations. One of those objectives is that their response time objective be less than 6 minutes. And right now that objective is being met around 14% of the time for responses to Hickory Island. I believe, and if I'm misstating, the applicant can please correct me, I believe the metric calls for at least an 80% approval for the response times.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you. So in order, with the next closest station being, I think it's 28055 Mango Drive, which The future slide will show a map of the next closest fire station to sort of give you a visual understanding of the distance that we're talking about here. And in order for this facility to function properly, the applicant would need to be able to house a truck on site. And the proposed location, in conjunction with the requested setback reductions, logistically serve as the only available location to be able to put up a structure in which to house a truck in. Tying into this request, staff has received several letters of opposition from surrounding property owners. As you know, we send out courtesy notices to all property owners within 375 feet of this property, letting them know that there is a zoning action taking place, and they do have the opportunity to respond and provide feedback. I do have a copy of those letters that were sent back to the city that I will submit for the record. And there were some very substantial concerns. Most of them centered around the use of a fire station itself, and not so much focused on the request at hand being for a setback reduction for the accessory structure in conjunction with a truck. There just seemed to be a lot of opposition to the use itself. On the flip side, in the few instances that staff did see a recommendation of support from the general public, it was along the same lines. It wasn't necessarily support for the request itself in terms of a setback reduction. It was support for the use of a fire station in general being in that area. So this is just a map showing the, go back that way. This is a map that shows the location of the fire station. I have it highlighted in blue there. That's where we're talking. And right in that area where my pointer is where the proposed location is for the Cheeky Hut accessory structure. And this map shows you the next closest fire station, which is Mango Drive over here, and the requested location, which is up here. So you can kind of see the distance. And I believe in terms of a metric, the response time coming from the Mango Fire Station to get to the north part of Hickory Island, I believe, is around 11 minutes, which is almost double the required metric of less than 6 minutes. This is an example of the current condition of the site and the area right now where the proposed Cheeky Hut is to go. Right now it's gravel based. It does have two parking spaces that are there, and this is an example of the location of where they would like to put it. A different perspective from the aerial. They do have condos directly behind them. I believe it's the Sea Isle Condominium, and those are their tennis courts right there. Another example right here. This picture was chosen to demonstrate the existing landscape buffer that separates this commercial retail center from the neighboring residential Sea Isles Condominium. That buffer is not going to be compromised, removed, or altered as a result of this request. And mirroring this picture is a rendering sent to us from the applicant showing what it is they would like to erect. That is an example of the size and scale of the proposed Cheeky Hut structure that they would like to do. Staff does have some concerns about the size and scale of that type of structure, and these concerns were brought up to the applicant, who would be able to respond to them here today. And it's also my understanding that that is the type of truck that they would like to be able to house on site in order for it to be a fully functioning emergency response facility. Tying into this request, aside from the rendering, you can see that there's additional landscaping that's going up right here. There is another graph coming up that shows a bit more detail of a permit that was submitted in conjunction with this request for that additional landscaping to create an additional buffer along Hickory Boulevard. So we are going to go from no coverage right now, where it's just wide open there to Hickory, to having coverage along Hickory Boulevard right here with the addition of cocoa plums and paradise trees. There's another request also in with Lee County Department of Transportation to do some work within the road right-of-way, including the addition of a proposed asphalt walkway and also additional sod to go within the right-of-way. So they are taking the attribute of providing additional barriers and buffers to Hickory Boulevard. So this is an example of the proposed pad location outlined in bold there as in conjunction to the road right-of-way. So yes, it is meant to be a 20 by 32 concrete slab that would reduce the setback significantly on that site. I lost it there for a second. So we are talking about a 2.7 foot setback from the road right-of-way of Hickory Boulevard as requested. There are comprehensive plan considerations that staff did consider when reviewing this request with regards to the future land use element being general commercial. There is no inconsistency there. Probably the bigger portion of the comp plan that staff looked at was the intergovernmental coordination element of the comprehensive plan, which does show that staff has responsibility along with the fire control district to work together in a number of areas, including information exchange involving the district and the review permitting process, coordination with the district for long-range planning efforts, emergency management, technical assistance with regards to future fire and rescue center locations, and methods to improve the district and city's ISO or PPC rating, which is the public protection classification rating. It's directly related to insurance rates and a jurisdiction's ability to fight fire, as well as impact fees, 9/11 enhancements, and other aspects of the fire prevention code. So there is a comprehensive plan component with regards to staff coordinating and working with the fire district on requests such as these. If this request were to be approved, staff does have some very specific conditions that they would like to attach to this approval, including limiting the variance, obviously, to the lot in question, the understanding that the entirety of the proposed structure to be contained within the 20 by 32 slab, so no overhang, no additional encroachments beyond the requested setback variance, landscaping and buffering in accordance with the site plan that was shown before and is also an attachment in your file, and that the height and scale of the structure be sensitive to the nearby residential uses. And this is something, again, that staff would like the applicant to respond to today with regards to some of the concerns about the height and scale. We understand that there are some specific fire codes, I believe, that mandate a certain separation distance between the top of the truck to the under roof of a structure. We'd like the applicant to speak a little bit more on that. Also, the fact that there are to be no right-of-way encroachments, any structural encroachments of any kind, and that is per a requirement from Lee County Department of Transportation, also noted in your file, and that the applicant needs to receive a local development order approval from the City of Bonita and Lee County DOT prior to the structure being erected. They have submitted for both of those permits. Obviously, ours is on hold pending this request. They also need to contact the utility company, Bonita Springs Utilities, prior to planting their trees to make sure that they're not disrupting any service laterals on the property. Relocation of the two existing parking spaces, that was a condition that staff felt it was appropriate to put in here. The property in question and the neighboring property, this one here, are under the same ownership. Even though they are two separate pieces, they are under unified ownership. And the two parking spaces that are on this side where the Cheeky Hut is to go are required parking spaces for that shopping center. So staff didn't feel it was appropriate to do away with them. The applicant agreed to a potential relocation of those spaces on the adjacent lot and a shared parking agreement being forged to accommodate the parking for both parcels at that point. So we did feel that was a necessary condition of approval if it were to be approved. And also that granting this variance would only be in conjunction with a fire station use. So should this use cease to exist, that the structure and I believe an addition was made to the slab as well, be removed and that the site be returned to its original configuration and formulation, or that they bring the existing or the proposed structure into compliance with the setback requirements. And then all other regulations in LDC 4-662 and 4-1893 should remain in full effect. So those are the conditions that we attach to the approval should it go that way. And with that, if you have any questions of myself or the applicant.
I have a question, which I'm sure the applicant's going to address, but one has to do with the height of the structure, which has already been mentioned. I think it was mentioned that there has to be so much distance between the top of the truck and the top. But before I get into that, I haven't heard any mention that that station is on a curve in the road.
Correct.
And traffic comes off the island at a pretty good clip sometimes. Mm-hmm. Not so fast going the other way because of congestion and what have you. But what are the plans for signals to control traffic at that point?
There is a request in with Lee County Department of Transportation as part of their approval to put the signalization lights on the ground in the event that the truck needs to come out. I believe that's, am I saying that correctly?
No, not from us right now. What we do have plans is there, before the curve and after the curve, there are existing signs already, and we are going to put fire station signs there with the flashing yellow triangles. That's our plan right now, as per DOT.
So when there is a call that you're responding to, there won't be any additional signals?
No, the only, and I actually, if you'll note, the only station that has that right now is the station on Hickory or on Mango Drive coming out on the Benita Beach Road. All the rest of our stations do not have any type of signaling.
That may be true, but other districts do have that.
Some of them do.
Estero, for example.
Estero does, and I'll give you the for instance. The biggest reason why it's an added cost, it's almost $400,000 for a light like that with a preemptive.
We know.
Yeah, we know that lime tree. So yeah. That's one of the reasons, but we are going to do our due diligence and put the signs on the two curves in the sign and the before and after the curve.
Okay. I would like to, make it part of the record that if that proves to be inadequate, we would require additional signals to control traffic. I'm concerned about the safety aspect of it, especially coming from the north. I don't know if anybody else shares that concern, but it is one that I thought of. So I would like to make that part of any motion that we leave ourselves open to go back and revisit that at some time in the future, okay, should it become an issue. Does somebody want to mention? Okay, I thought she was coming up to talk about it. Okay.
I have a question, Mr. Sure. Chairman.
Any other questions from
yes,
the board?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Chief?
Yes, sir.
Do you think, first of all, I agree with our chairman. That is a bad curve when you come around. Mm-hmm. We should do something about that. But the vehicle that's pictured there,
yes.
Is that the vehicle that's going to be stationed there?
Yes.
Will that do the adequate job as far as?
What it is what we've purchased. We've already purchased it. It's being outfitted now with equipment. It's a 2015 Ford F-550 with a 1,500 GPM pump, gallon per minute pump, with 400 gallons of water on it. We feel that it is more than adequate to do the initial knockdown of any type of fire. If we have to hook to a standpipe, we will have a large diameter hose on it so it can hook to a fire hydrant,
right,
and supply any fire pump within that area itself. The only, I would call, downfall to that truck is that it may not be able to carry all the equipment that a normal size fire truck would carry.
Right.
But it will not hinder us in doing our job as a first response. Because like we said, within 6 to 8 minutes, 11 minutes, we will have another truck there either from Fort Myers Beach or from our Mango Drive station. So we can get there, start any type of fire suppression, vehicle accidents, emergency medical, and backup. That truck will be a licensed ALS engine, through the state of Florida, so it will carry every life-saving tool that we have on any of the other engines, whether it be drugs, heart monitor, anything as such.
And how many people will man the station?
There will be three people at that station at all times. We'll never go below three people. And the other thing I think that hasn't been mentioned also, this is also going to be a station for our Marine unit. We are, in our lease agreement, we do have a dock that is going to have a boat lift on it. So we will have our Marine unit down there, which is a 26-foot twin V, which will be responding out of that dock area also. The other thing, if I would, and just because for my own, just so I can say it, if we can go back a couple slides, I just want to, when we talk about the setbacks, go to the aerial slide if you don't mind. When we're talking about the setbacks, that one right there, it's 2.5 feet from the right-of-way, not the road. I don't want people to think that we're going to be right next to the roadway. We're 2.5 feet away from the road, from the setbacks. From that setbacks, we're going to have shrubbery and trees also. So we're still a good, 10, 15, 20 feet away from the actual side of the road. So I just don't want to get people to get caught up that we're 2 feet away from the road itself where cars are whizzing by. And kind of going back to the chairman's concern is, as you see there where it says Cocoa Plum, that's how we're going to have to get out of that station. So we're not going to be exiting right out onto the roadway. We're going to be coming out into the existing parking lot and then making our right or left. At that point, and I know this is some of the concerns of the residents, we will have our emergency lights on, not so much our sirens on, but our emergency lights on at that point, being very visible to oncoming traffic either way.
Good, because I know some of the letters that were forwarded on to this board, a number of the residents seemed to be more concerned of the use, as was already stated, as a fire station, and especially the use of the sirens, especially more so at night, I suppose, than during the day, but at all times.
Right, and currently right now, our last statistical run, or whatever you want to call it, we run about 500 to 600 calls down there per year. So it's not like it's not an overabundance of calls like other stations where we're running, 2,000 calls out of one station. It's going to be a limited number of calls, and some of those will be at night. But again, we're not going to use our sirens unless we need to.
That would be more probably to clear the intersection.
It would be just to clear the intersection or to move traffic out of the way. At 2 o'clock in the morning, if the one's coming down the road, we're not turning sirens on just for, just because. I mean, even though state statute says we're supposed to, anytime emergency lights are flashing, we're supposed to have our sirens, our audio device on, but we usually don't practice that.
Thank you.
Chairman Brunswick?
Yes.
If I may just quickly address a concern that was brought up earlier with regards to additional signalization. The Hickory Boulevard road right-of-way is maintained by Lee County. It is not a city-maintained or city-owned road right-of-way, so we would not be able to mandate a request that additional signalization go within the road right-of-way. I just wanted to confirm that. But Lee DOT did have a requirement for this fire station to provide a detectable warning within the road right-of-way as part of their county permit.
A detectable warning is what?
I believe it's what the applicant suggested before with the signs and the light.
Okay, so you're saying if we in any motion that we put forward, we can't mention the additional need for signalization at some time in the future?
Well, what I would be saying is that we would not be able to mandate that happen within the road right-of-way, since the city does not have jurisdiction within the road right-of-way.
Okay.
If it were to happen, it would end up on the private property of the applicant.
All right.
Which may or may not be the most visually. Yeah,
that may not help people coming from the from the north.
Correct.
Yes. Jennifer, you're standing there.
It's Jacqueline Ginson for Jacqueline. Community development. No problem.
I do that.
Yeah, the county does have standards and specifications for signalization and clearance spacing, so that would have to be into consideration. So if you were to propose a condition, just as Mr. Fegan stated, we necessarily couldn't mandate it because it is the county's jurisdiction and they have certain specifications in place on how to do signalization. That they might have something different for fire stations, we just don't know. We can look into that if you like, and have that answer at time of council.
Yeah, I think that's something that we need to consider going forward. If this passes, it's a big enough concern for me. I don't know if it is for any of the other board members or
yeah,
not.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Or even the residents that travel that road.
We just wanted to let you know it's something that we couldn't necessarily mandate.
Okay.
But we could definitely work with them.
Thank
to
you.
See what's feasible.
Thank you, Jackie. Sorry about that. Okay, any other comments from the board?
I have some questions.
Yes, Barbara.
I was hoping to get some updates on what the plans are for DOT to widen Hickory Boulevard or any turning lanes or movements in there. Can someone address that possibly?
For the record, Jacqueline Genson, Lee County DOT was a review party on this application. They did not provide comments relative to the bridge replacement and the modifications. We trust that their review did take that into consideration when they reviewed this project.
What are the plans for widening in that area that are maybe on the MPO plan?
That I am not aware of. I can look into that for you, but I am not aware of that. But Ms. Vance could.
I know.
If you'll answer, that would be fine.
I know the county has indicated that there is scheduled to be a bridge replacement sometime between 2021 and 2024. That would be the type of replacement where they'd build the second bridge next to the current bridge and then demolish the current bridge after the new bridge is built.
How does that impact this piece of property as it?
Well,
as you do the approach normally.
Yeah, as I understand it, the bridge would be built to the east, so there's not a lot of space there. But we trust that the county took that into account when they review the LDO and when we've communicated with them.
And perhaps, do you all have an update on that by any chance?
No, we don't have an update on it. The only update we do have is that our LDO from Lee County has been approved already.
Okay. So, question, has this design been used in other areas?
As far as the Cheeky Hut?
Uh-huh.
Not that I know of.
No, not that I know of either.
We just went with the Cheeky Hut. I mean, we're not hung up on a Cheeky Hut. We just thought it would bring something to the area since the Little Hickory Fishing Nook has Cheeky Hut awnings down there and the island motif. And it was just something that we thought would jazz up the area. Again, we would love to have this a parking spot for our truck and to have a carport or something, some types of structure over our engine just for protection. But, at the end of the day, it's not a deal breaker. We could just park it in a parking spot. It's just one of those things we want to jazz up the area. If you go back two or three slides when you look at it, And no offense to the current owner, but it's kind of plain Jane. And what we're wanting to do is, jazz it up, maybe do a little bit of economic development, maybe bring some other people into that area. Because right now there is Freedom Boat Club and a realtor, and then the actual management has an office there. So we're just looking to bring something nice to the area.
Mm-hmm. And I guess my question was that it seems as if it's not necessarily exactly the same, for lack of a better term, flavor of the
right
area. And I didn't know if there was any brainstorming with I'm not sure who the designer was, or if you did any discussions with staff about how it would actually fit in and blend with the island, and if the surrounding residents had any input in it.
They didn't. We were just, mm-hmm. to be honest, we were sitting around like this talking, brainstorming, saying, hey, it's down on the beach, it's down towards that way, wouldn't it be nice to have a Cheeky Hut? And as far as the height, I know that was a concern. For our openings, we need about 13 foot. All our bay doors are 13 foot minimum. So if we could build it smaller, we will. Again, if the Cheeky Hut motif or look is an issue, we could just put a plain Jane, carport. there. We obviously, we're not going to put a structure there, as in with walls and a garage. We were going to go with something like a carport or
right.
Or
and
such.
And I'm sorry, I'm not really. I haven't been current on exactly what other items and aesthetics are happening in that area on the beach. And perhaps someone from the planning section might be able to update it. But it seems as if the Cheeky Hut, I'm not sure if there's a continuity or if there's something across the street at the parking area. Is there any blend? I'm just looking for something. It seems like that sticks out as the only.
I think the other reason why we leaned a little bit towards the Cheeky Hut is because if you go to one of the other ones, all along the back side of it is Eureka Palms around it. That's what the
right.
buffer is between that and Sea Isles. So we were just going to stick with that same little motif. Again, going back to the Little Hickory Fishing Nook, all their outside seating areas have umbrellas with the Cheeky Hut motif. So that's something we're going to. I know down the road at one of the residents, a couple of residents, they have Cheeky Huts down there. So that's what we were going with, just something in the area. Again.
And I guess my comment is just that once you set this, you know, put this in, it's there in almost perpetuity as a Cheeky Hut. So if that's how we want it's the entrance mm-hmm. basically to the city on that side. So I'm just questioning if that's the
look and feel.
Look and feel for the city of Bonita Springs.
Can I
at
add
that side of the city?
At the southern end, you have Coconut Jack's. Mm-hmm. That's all Cheeky Hut and everything. Freedom Boat Club just put in a new Cheeky Hut for their restrooms. And as you start heading north and everything, there's some areas where you start to see some Cheeky Huts.
Right.
They're privately owned or might be part of another place. But back to the height of it, it doesn't matter if it's a Cheeky Hut or any canopy. The height of it is like, says Chief DeWitt, says about 13 feet we need, because that truck might get rotated out to another station. You know, we might have it sent to the station for some training. In the meantime, one of the larger engines comes and stands by in that truck, in that station, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
The ladder truck might have to stand by there once in a while. Fort Myers Beach may have to come to stand by there. So that's, you know, it's not just size truck. It's going to be multiple sizes truck in there at one time.
So the largest truck that could be accommodated under the Cheeky Hut would be?
Well, fire code says a minimum height for clearance for fire trucks is 13.6.
Mm-hmm.
And our bay doors is about 13 feet high. So that's, you know, we're shooting for that height, that clearance. So when you're backing a truck in, when I started out many years ago in the fire service, we bought a truck with Iona McGregor, and the truck was so big and the doors weren't high enough
mm-hmm.
that we had to ease it into the bay, because if we touched on the brakes, it bounced. And there was marks on the top of the bay doors where that truck hit it every time. So that's, you know, we want to get that clearance so that truck can just park right in there and no problem.
But for the future, that truck is going to be the one there. I mean, fire trucks last about 10 to 15 years. We do not have any plans to put anything bigger than that there. Now, like Fire Marshal Fernandez says, there may be a time when someone has to stand by there. We run closest unit response at Fort Myers Beach. If we get busy in the core of Bonita Springs, Fort Myers Beach will bring an engine down there and stand by. But it will be for a limited time. It won't be for any length of time.
And are there any buildings, structures, residential structures that are not sprinklered that this truck cannot adequately handle a fire issue if it's on maybe a top floor? I mean, is this sufficient to provide the protection that is needed out on the beach?
We feel it is. I mean, like I said, it's all of our fire trucks, let's call it the full-size engines. This is called a mini pumper. All full-size engines are anywhere from 1,250 GPM pumps, gallons per minute, to our latest one we just bought that is housed at Station 2 is 2,000. So this is right in the middle of the actual gallons per minute that we would need at any type of structure. Our only concern, if there is a concern, is, you know, equipment. This will have the jaws of life on it. We are planning to put the jaws of life on it. It may not have what's called an exhaust fan to do ventilation right away, but we've got other trucks for that will come.
So you are saying that this truck will be able to accommodate and adequately
yep.
handle any issues on any structures that are
initially,
in
yes, any height. Because even if you let's use Sea Isles right next door, our ladder truck cannot ladder to the top of that building.
Right.
I mean, they have standpipes. This truck mm-hmm. will carry sufficient amount of hose. Right now, we are hoping to get 400 feet of large diameter hose and another 400 feet of 2.5, which will supply the supply from the hydrant to the fire pump or to sprinkler system. It's also going to have 2.5 or 1.75 pre-connects, so we don't have to hook up hose. You just pull it. It's already hooked up to the pump. Turn it on and go. So it's more than sufficient, and it's suppression-wise, suppression and hose-wise, it is what I would say 95% of all our engines carry now throughout the city of Bonita Springs.
Okay, a couple more questions.
Okay, no problem.
On the aesthetic issue, mm-hmm. Has this been reviewed through our architectural standards and?
If Jacqueline Getson for the record, it is going through our LDO review process right now. So Mr. Vincent has not looked at it yet. Also because it's a cheeky hut, it's not exempt from zoning setback standards, but it could be exempt from Florida Building Code standards. So there is a gray line with using an actual cheeky hut that is constructed by a Miccosukee tribe or Seminole tribe. So it really depends, so that we would use the variance document as the controlling aesthetic feature. So another option could be is to ask the district to look at, because we as staff, again, we're a little concerned with the overpowerment of the structure, is we could look at asking them to do a different alternative structure that mimics the current design of the building that's there now, if you'd like. So it could be more of a flat canopy design and using the ribbed corrugated metal feature. So we could look at that, asking the fire district to look at that to help bring it into continuity with the building. And that would help with the southbound approach over the bridge. But going northbound, there is a proposed buffer that Mr. Kirby can speak to in terms of assisting with screening and providing better curb appeal to the site.
Barbara, do you have something else?
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
Okay.
I have a question, something to comment too.
I think I would like a little more information as to the architectural review from Mr. Vincent and how it blends into the whole approach, the entrance to the city, and if this is the best. I mean, you're going to be providing a substantial amount of investment in this, and I'm not sure if there's an emotional tie-in to the Cheeky Hut, but I think it's very nice, but I'm not sure if it's the most appropriate in this area. And I certainly am totally supportive of having the fire station and the equipment there for the protection of our citizens and our visitors. I'm just questioning if that's the best type of design and facade right there.
Good morning.
Morning. Hi, John.
The only reason I came up here is just to provide a little bit of background on this. There are other Cheekies, and I think that the fire district has pointed those out along Hickory. There are also other uses with metal roofs. It appears that the building that this is be associated with at one time was attempting to be a Polynesian-style building. It has since modified the roof material and color so that I don't think it reflects its original design, but this is where we are. In terms of aesthetic review, as part of our LDO process, yes, it will be reviewed by Sam Vincent. The review of a Cheeky Hut obviously is not as detailed as that of a commercial structure, simply because there's not as much of it to review, but it will be part of the consideration as the LDO. When Mrs. Ginson was talking about the building code exemption, there have been some changes to that recently as to what is exempt and what is required. However, they still need to design it for wind loads. It's just how they prove that, I think, is really where we're distinguishing building permit data. But the LDO will go through as any other development order would in the city of Bonita Springs, but both from aesthetics and from design.
Could you explain what Jackie was mentioning about exempting Cheeky Huts?
For as long as I can remember, if a member of the Seminole Miccosukee tribe was constructing the Cheeky Hut, they would provide a letter to the local municipality that would exempt it from building permitting. There have been some changes to the statute that has exempted those, but I think that really goes to the constructor of the Cheeky Hut stating that it does meet wind load and it does meet the building code. However, I do not think, if my memory is correct, that they were going to be required to provide a building permit. Does not mean that they are exempt from a development order application. It just means that that last step is something that they self-certify.
And what are the plans on the continued maintenance of the adjacent building? Is that going to remain as it is? Did the owner indicate that? And are they planning on maintaining the roof as it is?
There have been no real discussions with the owner. It's mainly been the potential tenant in terms of design. I think that if this building were to be remodeled, obviously we'd be looking at going with a color and a material that would be a little more consistent with a cheeky design. I don't think the design of the roof itself would make it that difficult, but I believe the current materials and the current colors prevent that from happening.
And is this a situation where the fire department is leasing the property, or are you purchasing the property?
We right now we have a 99-year lease with the property owner and a first right of refusal if it does go for sale.
Okay. And it's not currently on the market, is that correct?
Not that we're aware of.
I haven't seen.
Thank you. Question.
If you could bear with me, just one.
Oh, sure.
Two more questions. I'm sorry. Just where's the Marine unit based currently?
Currently is at Station 2 on a trailer and being pulled by an F-250 pickup truck. And it will be relocated down there. We are in the permitting process right now of having a boat lift put in at the end of the dock. I don't know if they have that aerial shot of it, but it's at the end of the dock. The other comment I'll try and make is that all the structures and all that stuff, I think, will go before you guys at a later date with an LDO, correct? And this is just for a variance of the pad itself, because we want to work with staff and know exactly what you guys want there. I just, from your comments about the fire station, that's already, lack of better terms, a done deal.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's going there,
right,
whether we get this variance or not. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of how we're going to house our fire truck, either in a current parking space back then or on something a little bit more nicer, like I said before, to bring some more aesthetics to the area. Am I correct on that, Mr. Bell?
Mostly. He is correct. The fire station use is a permitted use on this property, mm-hmm. so we are not considering the
right.
use itself. We are considering the setback variance associated with that. The limited review development order process is entirely administrative and does not come back to either this board or to the council. However, conditions that you place upon a potential approval at this level will be carried through by your staff when we do review the development order. So if there are certain conditions in terms of aesthetics or in terms of landscaping or in terms of certain design features, we would then carry those through.
I guess my last question is, as the truck would exit, mm-hmm. Are you going to be able to make your turn to go south?
Yes.
Left?
Like I said, it's an F-550 truck. It's not a full-size. You know,
I was just curious on the radio.
Yeah, radiation, or not radiation, the radius of the truck is mm-hmm. can make it. And if you would, go back to that aerial shot, and I could use your pointer real quick. The actual boat, right here. The lift is going in on this last slip right here on the inside.
I think that's wonderful. And I think the fire station is definitely needed, and that's great to have it out there for the safety of the citizens and visitors. My only concern has to do with the aesthetics. I'm not necessarily that concerned on the variance issue per se, but if through the powers that be out there to review it, if a cheeky hut seems like it's the best design,
that
so be it.
That is up to a condition of this board and ultimately the city council. So if there is a design consideration or aesthetic that you wish us to enforce or to carry through as part of the development order, we would be happy to do it. But this would be the time that you would establish either an architectural style or a design aesthetic type feature.
It would be helpful if there were some alternatives that we could have looked at, like a Key West approach, maybe.
While it has not been presented as part of this presentation, Bonita Springs has generally looked at more of an old Florida type feel. Key mm-hmm. West, lack of a better word. If that is a direction that you wish us to go, I don't think the fire district is all that concerned. I think that they, from my discussions with them in the past, they've always been informal discussions in passing, but it's been that they wanted to come up with something that aesthetically looked island-like. Mm-hmm. And a Key West feel, a matching metal roof, might go along those lines. I think that they've done a good job with the landscaping. I think now it's, as you had addressed, carrying that into the design of the structure.
And my last question.
Second and last question. The last question.
Sorry. Just, are there going to be any other, like, connections, utilities, water tanks, or anything around on the pad?
The only thing that I can think of that may be out there is I'm not even going to call it a shed, would be a storage locker for the bunker gear, because by code we don't want to put our bunker gear inside the living structure itself. But that would be the only thing. There's nothing else that we foresee going to be there.
And what's the definition of the bunker gear?
Our turnout gear, the gear that we wear in a fire.
How many
there'll be,
outfits, so to
there'll
speak?
There'll be 9 sets of it, but it will be out of sight, out of mind. We're not just going to lay it out on the sidewalk. It
right.
would be in some, like a Rubbermaid or some type of structure that we would obviously get approval on. Wouldn't be a shed or anything like that. But
so would it be permanent, tied down?
Oh, yes. It would meet all the wind codes and all that stuff.
So 9 outfits would fit
9 suits with a helmet.
9 suits would probably fit into what size unit?
I'm not sure.
5x5, 10x10. I mean,
okay,
I'm
just
about, yeah.
thinking of it from a visual perspective, yeah. Cheeky hut and underneath.
What I think that we can do, because we'll say this item is something that we'll have to address, is a little bit in flux. Whatever they look to propose will have to match the architectural style that you are working towards conditioning right now. We have done this, and it's not obviously a direct comparison, but we've also done ice machines, outside facilities for different types of uses, and we've matched the architectural style one way or another for those facilities with the buildings that they were adjacent to. We would do the same thing here as long as this board and ultimately the city council were to go along with that architectural style. So that if you have something that you're looking for, we would be happy to carry that through. And I think that we would, because there's not a definite plan right now, we probably can't get into the small details of it, but I think the general overview and the general style of this type of structure, or lack of a better word, we can establish now.
So, John, you are saying that the aesthetics is determined associated with this variance request in front of us.
I'm saying that is well within your purview. As part of the reduction in setbacks, what they are doing is trying to show you that they are offsetting that proximity to the right-of-way with the landscape buffering and also the design of the structure. If this board and ultimately the city council feels that there are certain changes or conditions that also need to be included that promote that consistency or offset that impact, those are why we are here. So those are items that I think this board should consider. And if there are conditions that come out of that, we would be happy to present those to the council at their hearing.
Okay, and because of the close proximity to the roadway and the traveling public, I mean, it's right outside your window, and it's right in the entrance. I'm just concerned and that we may not have explored some of the other aesthetic approaches. I don't have a problem with the variance, and I'm really supportive of the fire station being out there. But I'm just concerned that once this is constructed, it's there in perpetuity. Those are my concerns. And once again, I don't have a concern with the variance. I just have a concern that the aesthetic approach and the design.
Well, I guess
right.
I guess throwing it back to you. What do you guys want to see? That's it. I mean, we came up with what we would like, but if this board or city council has a problem with what they want, we've got to have an idea in order to come back and say, yeah, hey, we'll do that, or no, we're not doing that.
And typically on some of the projects, we do have the benefit of maybe having some input from staff and our consultant, Sam Vincent, And that would be helpful if...
And I think that when you're looking at the site and what is there today, if you're looking for something that I'll say blends in a little bit more, what I think you'd be looking for is matching the roof pitch and material.
Not necessarily.
But this, we had agreed with the cheeky design, because there are cheeky designs along Hickory. The Bonita Bay Beach Club is a cheeky hut. The Coconut Jacks has a very large outdoor seating area. So it's not uncommon or unprecedented. However, matching the existing building in an attempt to kind of disguise the carport.
Not area. Necessarily matching it, but enhancing it, maybe.
Well,
I think that's the other, that's something that we're looking to do also. If we're making all these so-called upgrades and doing that, mm-hmm. hopefully, because if you go back to the front view of it, they do, go back to that one, John. As you see, it's not really the blue as you see in our artist rendition. It's more of a baby blue, faded blue. Mm-hmm. So whatever we put there is going to be, unless we find some weathered aluminum, it's going to stand out no matter what we put there, a brand new carport or a brand new cheeky hut or a blue same, let's call it the same roof structure of this, it's going to stand out different than this building.
And in that effort, I would say that if you're looking to go along the same type of lines, I would look at maybe not a blue metal roof, but maybe like
I wasn't really looking to go along with the same type of lines, but there might be something that's better, that still looks good, that's better. And I
can think of a lot of things that would be better than that existing roof. However, in terms of the purview today, I don't know how far this board is looking to go. I don't disagree with your focus. I think that the building at one time probably looked to go along that Polynesian type of architecture. When they changed the material of the roof, I think that took away a lot of that feature. It just left the roof pitch and some cues as to what it used to be. So now I think that when you're looking at a potential carport, there are a few options to play off of what's there, but I don't know if any of those options are really better than the cheeky design.
I would just like to have the benefit of Mr. Vincent's comments on it in light of some of the design standards that the city has implemented.
Obviously adopted. he would be associated with the LDO review process. If you would like him to be more directly related in the presentation to City Council, that's also within your purview, and we'd be happy to do that as well. So I don't know, however you would like to handle it.
Excuse me, but I need to interrupt here, because we're getting way off the subject. We're here to talk about a setback, and we're not here to address the design. Personally, I like the design. I think it's a little too high. I'd rather see a flatter roof. But, that can come later. We're here for the setback, and we've listened to a lot of comments from everybody on this panel. So I just want to get back on track here. And we can talk about the design.
It was my understanding that they said that the design was also part of our review. And I'm sorry if I misunderstood that. I apologize.
Wherever this board wishes to go, we will follow.
Well, that's very kind of you, John, but I was here to talk about a request for a setback. So I'd like to move along if there's any other questions regarding the setback issue.
I have a question regarding the setback issue. If you look at the site plan, can we look at the site plan again, please? That's it. Now, obviously, the setback at the lower part of the drawing is for the new structure is in line with the existing building. So I guess there's already a pre-existing variance to the rear setback line. So the issue is more of the setback to the new structure to the left. If you look at the overall site plan, there seems to be other alternate locations on this site for the building. Is that true?
Staff would have to disagree with that. If I take you to this aerial here, that gives you a pretty rough idea of where the property lines for this specific parcel actually are. There really isn't, you know, you have your required parking here, you have some parking here, and then the building is almost pressed right up against the property line here to the east. This is the only logistical location where any additions would be able to occur, provided a variance is granted for the setbacks.
But it's common owner for both of
Correct.
The lots.
Yes, it is.
So if the lots were merged, we wouldn't have this setback
Correct.
Problem. You could put the building to the other end.
We'd have to take a look at what this easement is here, because obviously we're not going to any structures to go into an easement or into a dedicated park area, but it would...
You'd have to scrap some parking spaces, but you're scrapping some parking spaces.
To relocate, correct.
As it is now, you'd have to relocate those. So there could be an alternate, since there's common owner, there could be an alternate location for this building, and the big setback problem would go away.
Potentially.
Potentially.
Right now, because of the fact that they are two separate addresses, two separate strap numbers,
okay.
with the request being tied to this one, if the goal is to allow the fire truck to be directly adjacent to the unit that houses the firemen, the personnel, this is logistically the area that makes the most sense.
So there's a retail space that you rent out for the,
right,
the house firemen.
Right. The fire department is going to rent the end unit here, directly adjacent to the proposed
right.
structure.
Right. Okay. Right. Is the rental unit at the other end of the building available?
I believe there are a total of four units,
no.
and I believe the other one is not available at the other end.
Okay.
There's five units.
Five units, sorry.
There's five units. We're taking the N2 that used to be the Island Deli. The next
two,
door,
two units.
Yeah, it's two units. The one next door to it is a realtor. The one next to that one is the Freedom Boat Club. And the last unit, which is very small, is the office for the manager, Jennifer, who runs both the Little Hickory Fishing Nook and this plaza.
Right. Okay. The last question I have was the when you made your initial presentation, you talked about the required matrix for response time.
Mm-hmm.
That's the word required. Is it required? Who requires it? Or are you in violation now or something?
No,
or,
what it is there's a standard of care that's throughout the United States, and our fire board puts on us a standard of care. And I misheard before. What it is our fire board has said that they want us to be on any medical scene within 4 to 6 minutes, 85% of the time. Right now, department-wide, we meet that. But on Little Hickory Island, we do not meet that. To go to Lover's Key, it's about a 14-minute trip from the Mango Drive. So we put that on ourselves. Now, could we change that? Yes, but that's like changing your monthly budget on how much money you want to spend. We want that for the standard of care for everybody in Bonita Springs. And, you know, and we kind of mirror from American Heart Association with CPR for, you know, within 4 minutes, your heart starts to die from lack of perfusion, strokes the same way. So that's where we kind of get that from. There also is another standard. It's called NFPA 1710, which, again, is a standard that says that on any given fire, you should have your first unit there within 6 to 8 minutes, and then the remainder of it 10 to 12 minutes after that, which is 16 personnel. So those are standards out there, and that's what we like to follow, if available. Like I've been at Bonita Springs Fire Department for 28 years now. This is the first time we've had something available down on the beach.
Right.
So we've been striving for it, just never found the right fit yet.
Have you spoken to Lover's Key?
We've spoken to Lover's Key in the past, about 15 years ago. We've spoken to them in the last year and a half. The problem with Lover's Key is that it's a state park, and the state will give us the land, but you have to demonstrate a positive impact for them, not the city of Bonita Springs or not the community of Bonita Springs, but for the state of Florida. What is the positive for them to put something there? When we did talk to them, the park ranger down there, They were willing to give us a place to put our boat, and that's it at the time. And we asked them if anybody else has a fire station within a state park. She didn't know of any in the surrounding area. So we have looked at state, we looked at that, we've talked to BSU by the water tower. We've actually looked, had talked to CenturyLink at the corner of McLaughlin and Bonita Beach Road, or Hickory Boulevard, I'm sorry. We had a line on that, and we're going to put it out there. We were met with opposition from the residents that it was in a residential area, and we understood that. So at one of our town hall meetings, they requested, hey, look at the commercial ends of the island. So that's when we went back to Little Hickory and spoke to them, and they were more open to it now.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Do we have any other questions? Okay, seeing none, we want anybody from the public, would you want to make a presentation?
Sir? My only presentation would be, it's we've got the fire station there, we were looking for a place to house it. I've said it before, I think it what we're going to provide there, other than medical response and fire response, is I think it's going to bring a better aesthetics to the area. We've already agreed to the landscaping, to the buffering. What you guys decide, or what the LDO decides as far as a structure to house our truck, we're just looking for something to shade our truck. We know how the sun is, and we just don't want that truck to, its life to be altered by the sun and not having some type of shade. And also, it's for some of the protection to our firefighters. If you notice right there where the firefighter is standing, that we've knocked a hole in the side of the hole. We've put a door there, and that's how the firefighters are going to exit to get to the truck. So it's going to provide some protection to the firefighters going out to that truck, when we have those summer storms or whatever. So it's going to provide the protection for them too, getting in and out of that truck itself.
Good. Thank you. At this time, I'd like to ask for any public comment. Please come forward. You're a resident down there, aren't you, Rick?
Yeah, I'm with a stone's throw. I must be 351 feet away from this.
They got a couple of rocks they're going to keep just for that case.
Well, you got this picture up here. That's all truck. That's not a storage bin behind that truck.
Correct. That's the rescue body of the truck itself.
Okay, good. There's... You don't plan on putting a storage bin out there, I suppose.
If we do, it's going to be like Ms. Barnes Buchanan made the comment about where that firefighter is in that back corner. If we're going to put anything, that's where it would be, to house only firefighting gear, because of the carcinogens in it. We don't allow the gear to come into the living quarters themselves.
Okay, very good. As you know, I welcomed the fire department to this location, partially because it's their right to be there. Of course, I work for the people who live on Little Hickory Island, and they're kind of picky. And I'm supposed to find some reason for you guys not to do this, but I do have some concerns. If we could go to another picture up there.
The overhead?
That one there, back there. You see the water? The drainage problem in that area, the dust from that gravel on that turn, it needs to be addressed somehow.
It is, if you go to the larger one.
The LDO.
The LDO
I
one?
I see.
Go to the, actually, the...
The one showed
that one.
Back.
If you look right here, excuse me one second, Rick.
Okay.
Grab the pointer. LDO is...
Yeah.
LDO.
Try to speak into the microphone if you can, Greg.
Sorry about that. What we've been required through Lee County with our LDO is we have to take this existing sidewalk and take it to the end of the structure, or to the end of the property line. We've got to provide that. And then any of this drainage right here is going to sheet flow back
to the south,
to this area right here. So all this, for your concern, Mr. Steinmeier, this is all going to be landscaped, buffered, and a sidewalk through there. and the drainage will come back to this south area this way to where the Lee County has deemed where it needs to go. So there will, hopefully there'll be no more standing water in this area, because this is all going to be brought up.
You know, that area drains that whole.
And all that in the top is pavement.
And all that in the top is pavement, where you see the little circle. Yep, that's all pavement.
Where's that water that's in the puddle going to go now?
If I may.
Okay.
321 feet south to your house.
Hi, Stuart Smith, development engineer. We are processing the LDO concurrent with this, and we've already taken care of that with the engineer. The ponding water that he's referred to will move now to the south and into that swale south of this area. There'll be no more ponding. As Mr. Fernandez said, the asphalt's going to be increased from where it is now into the site, so there'll be less dust and dirt.
Good.
Good job.
That answer that question, Rick.
Well, that takes care of part of the problem on that turn. The rest of it is gravel, sand, and dust. Huge plumes of dust when people come around that turn. Sand on the road, I know Greg will tell me how many times you've been out for accidents on that turn. There's been lots of people killed and lots of accidents on that turn, and sometimes they end up in my front yard, the cars do. I see a problem with the dust causing the vision problem. The sand on the road makes a traction problem. I would hope I know they have addressed some of this problem with the drainage. I wish we could get some more of it. There's a Bonita Beach Resort timeshare in there. There's a Bay Park North City Park in there.
I think most of your dust area, if we go to the aerial, if you notice right there, all of this, let me see your pointer again. Sorry about that.
No problem.
Most of your dust, I believe right now, Mr. Steinmeier, is coming from this area. Well, this area is all going to be paved and or landscaped to this area right here. Okay. Well, so then you have the park, the actual asphalt going into the condo there. Then you have the park over here. So I believe most of your concern, because this pavement's going to come all the way out to here.
Oh, okay.
Up to the sign. This is all going to be paved.
That's shown on the...
Because if you go... Right. If you go
that'll
to...
definitely make a difference.
Sure will.
Yeah. Yep.
This picture, well, it's going to take all this... This is all going to be pavement and landscape. So all the only dust or gravel that you're going to have is from the edge of the building this way, which is... The scale is, it's quite a ways from the actual roadway itself.
Okay, that's very, that's much, all right, that picture of that one there.
Yep.
This is the new pavement.
Correct, this is the new, this is the new pavement. Here's where the gravel's gonna start in this artist rendition, is at the edge of the building. This is all pavement coming out to the actual edge of the roadway.
Okay, now if this does not take care of the dust, your fire, your equipment's going to get covered with dust, and fire trucks aren't dirty.
So we're washing it every day, every morning.
How you guys keep them clean? Next question. What are the chances of putting enclosing that cheeky hut, just put tarps around it and look like heck, block the view and everything else because of the dust?
We won't. Well, because of the LDO, we will not be able to do that. We're not asking for that type of... variance to enclose that structure.
Okay, another thing is that building was built, the elevation on the end of the island is higher now than when that building was built. Because, well, I worked on sea isles too, and the big hickory fishing nook burnt, and they had to, when they rebuilt it, they had to bring it about 2 feet higher because of the elevation. So it would, You probably can't enclose that without really making a big change.
Correct. In order to enclose it, because this is part of when we did the remodeling of the unit that we're doing, because of the 50% rule, if that was going to be enclosed, it would have to be, what was it, 17 feet off the ground?
That was for the building itself.
Right.
It would be a different code altogether.
Be a different code altogether. Yeah, so yes. It will never be enclosed, like I said.
You're right on that. Another question. Okay, that cheeky hut shows like you talked about protecting the fireman as he comes out that door. Now, where does that side of the cheeky hut drain? Does that drain onto the existing building? I know they're not, they can't be connected, or
no, it won't be
something
connected.
Else. So that you're going to, it's going to come down the side of that building or hit the, I see a shadow on the side there.
I'm not sure. I mean, we haven't had it engineered, but I'm sure it'll have some type of eaves or a drainage.
Excuse me again. These are all good questions, and I appreciate everybody's interest and concern and how it all looks, Rick.
You appreciate my concern? Well, let me give it to you.
But we're here to talk about to grant a variance, a reduction, and not so much the design.
Well, this is the design that's being presented. The reason they want this is a hardship for them, so that's why they want a variance, which is to change the law because they think they're being hurt by the law.
I understand what you're saying, but that's not our purpose in being here this morning.
I don't see where public comment's on the agenda anyways. I don't know why it isn't. But thank you for letting me speak, and thank you. Freedom of speech is being eliminated all the time. I don't see where you're not concerned about what the neighborhood's got to put up with and different concerns that I've mentioned. It has a lot to do with the variance. It's completely to do with the variance. So thank you, Roger.
Thank you, sir. Any other public comment? Okay, seeing none. Any further discussion? Do we have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to accept the request for variance to the setback.
I'll second that motion, Mr. Chairman.
Discussion?
Yes, I would hope that the entertainer of the motion might be able to amend it to include that the applicant coordinate with the architect, Sam Vincent, to at least look at several alternatives prior to it going back to the City Council.
Prior to the City Council?
Right, prior to going back to the City Council. The City Council will still have the ultimate decision. We can still approve the fact that we're approving the variance, but I'd still like to see the opportunity for the applicant to work with the staff consultant on the aesthetics and just see if there are alternatives.
I understand the design concern that you have, and mm-hmm. I have some myself. But here again, I'm not certain that the design is what we're here for this morning. Now, we can make a request for the city architect, for Sam Vincent, to get with the district and look at the design. But I don't think that it's appropriate for that to be part of our motion. Can I have a legal opinion on that?
Well, I think you can make it clear that will happen. I think that will happen, though, and it's as part of the LDO, and that's all stated and will be, you know, on the record when presented to City Council.
Right now, as the request is phrased, it's phrased for an accessory structure or a cheeky hut dash accessory structure, so we're not just limiting it to a cheeky hut. Staff did that on purpose to allow room for negotiation for the aesthetic components. So if the question is, or if the request is that we have all that flushed out before City Council, is that what?
Well, I just think that it would be helpful for a decision maker to have the alternative so that we are not in this vague, ambiguous question, is it going to be a cheeky hut or not? So I think that's really important for a final decision. And just at some point, I probably need some clarification from the legal staff after this item as to what the role is. As I read it in the ordinance, the role of this board is also to look at things like that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any further discussion? Roll call.
Barbara Barnes Buchanan.
Could you read back the motion?
Sure. The motion that I, as I understand, is recommending approval of a variance for a reduction for a street setback along Hickory Boulevard. That's for 22.3 feet, and a 12.4 reduction to a side yard setback for an accessory structure in conjunction with the fire station.
Thank you.
Okay, roll call, please.
Barbara Barnes Buchanan.
A.
Aye.
Robert Inserby.
Yes.
Chairman Brunswick.
Aye.
Richard Donnelly.
Aye.
Frank Lyles.
Aye.
James Worcester.
Yes.
Okay, the motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have an order of business here for a motion to approve the minutes from our meeting of August 16th. Do we have August 16th,
right,
and September 20th? Both to be. Let's take a motion to approve the minutes of August 16th.
Make a motion. We accept the minutes.
Second, please.
I'll second the motion.
Can we do a voice vote, or do we need all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And the minutes of September 20th, a motion to approve. Do I hear a motion to
approve?
I'll
make a motion that we approve the minutes.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second. And all in favor, say aye.
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 Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your input this morning, and this meeting is adjourned.